I'm scared of you right now. I'm very, very deeply scared of you right now. A girl needs therapy, let's just say that. Hello everyone, if you're new here, my name is Sarah Burgett, or if you are a subscriber, welcome back to my channel. I'm super, super glad you guys clicked on today's video. I was thinking of the first video I wanted to make for 2021, and why am I already starting to cry? And with every video I was brainstorming, I could not get this video out of my head to film, and it's not something that I ever thought I would ever, ever film, ever. or ever experience, but it is something that needs to be talked about more, and I decided to sit here today and do that for you guys. Basically, I went through something very traumatic in 2020 that I feel like pulled my relationship with you guys apart a little bit, because if you know me in real life, even if you don't, you know that I am all about female empowerment, being a boss ass, living your life by your terms no matter what. Those are things that I am so internally passionate about. People ask me what my channel's about, and I'm like, oh, I used to make makeup tutorials, but now I'm just all about living your best life. And I got to a point in 2020 where I didn't recognize myself, and I was not living by those rules, and I know a lot of you guys noticed it and DM'd me, and I was just ignorant. It's like almost I saw a bunch of red flags, but suddenly I was colorblind. So I haven't even talked about what I'm gonna be talking about in today's video, but I did want to give a quick trigger warning. In this video, I will be talking about domestic violence, physical abuse, emotional abuse, verbal abuse, all of the above, mental health, disassociating, losing yourself. Let's just say 2020 was not a good year. I know it wasn't for anyone. So in today's video, I will be talking about my abusive quarantine relationship. If you've been on my channel for a while, you know that I am a hopeless romantic at heart. I hate to be that girl, but I feel like I am always in a relationship. I love loving fully. I felt like my purpose in this world is to, like I said, help people find themselves and love themselves for who they are. I can find the best out of everyone I talk to in this world, and I used to think that was my greatest feature until it wasn't. So yeah, today I will be talking about my experience. I hope this video isn't too long, and I hope that this helps at least one person watching, because if I saw a video like this before I was in this situation, it would have helped me immensely. And I'm so surprised I'm crying, because I'm on antidepressants and I never cry anymore, and I feel like it's just because, like, I can't afford to go to therapy. So this is like, you talking to you guys like deep like this is kind of my therapy. If you saw my video in 2017 opening up about all my breakups, that video is one of the most popular famous videos on my channel when it comes to people I helped. And I actually just watched that video and started tearing up myself, because, you know, I didn't stay true to my word. And no one in this life is perfect. There's no handbook to this thing called life. But it really sucks going back and watching a lesson you've learned and having to relearn it because you didn't learn it fully. But that's life. You're never gonna be able to be perfect. I think a lot of the stigma against YouTubers is they seem really perfect. But even if I seem perfect on my Instagram or my YouTube and I have this smiling face, everyone is broken in their own way, and I think that that's very important to know. You see people like Kylie Jenner and all these people just like being so powerful and so put together. You never know what's going on behind closed doors. Always treat people with kindness. It's really, really important, especially in this day and age. I'm so sorry, I'm so emotional already. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, okay, let me get myself together. Get it together, Sarah. If you get anything out of this video, even if you never have been through this, no one plans to get through this, but just treat people with respect and kindness. I think that's the most important thing you can do. So yeah, let's just get into it. I guess I need some backstory. As you guys know, I was dating a boy named Garrett. I would say he is one of my soulmates in this lifetime. Great, great human. We lived in LA together for 2 summers. We dated for over 1.5 years, almost 2 years. And basically, we lived in LA, we came back for him to graduate. Also, this video is not about him. Let me just throw that out there. He's a great guy. We love him. We went to LA together and we came back because he needed to graduate college and I had a couple jobs lined up here that I could do to save money until I was out in LA for good, because that was our like overall plan. And it came to a point where I wasn't as financially stable as I thought I would be to move to LA full time. And he was, and it got in the way of our dreams, and he makes music and I didn't want to get in the way of his dreams. It was basically just like wrong timing, and we ended things. Of course, we ended things, and then quarantine happened. Comment down below if you got out of a relationship right before this pandemic happened, because let me tell you, boy, is that not fun. So even his plans got pushed back, because everything was pushed back because the world was in shambles come March. That was really, really hard, but I distracted myself from it by being a workaholic, I guess, before the pandemic. It happened a little before the pandemic happened, and I would just work every single day, day in and day out, at the bar I was working at the time. I was a bartender. And yeah, it was whatever. Like, I'm an independent person to the point where, like, I know it's not a good thing to deal with things by ignoring them, but that's just how I do it, because I'm also a very big empath and I'm a Pisces. I just feel things very, very deeply, and it is physically easier for me to pretend something didn't happen, to get over it, than to deal with it head on. And yeah, that's not advice I'm giving you guys. A girl needs therapy, let's just say that. But yeah, that happened, and I was just living my life, and then of course this pandemic happened, and I had nothing to distract myself with. I was just in my thoughts all the time, and I was like, hey, I never really get weekends off or weekdays off, so I would hang out with my one or two friends I hung out with during the quarantine, whatever, and we would drink, and we would, you know, smoke a little. We would distract each other, I guess, in a way. I think a lot of people were doing that at the beginning of quarantine, to like forget all this craziness and this madness that was going on in the world. I'm a very, very big extrovert, and that's why I was good at bartending. I love human interaction. I love it. So basically, long story short, it came to a point where I was going to my friend Kendall's, who is one of those people I was hanging out with, and we were painting, and I'm gonna do different names. Let's just say my friends Dan and Stan. We're gonna call them Dan and Stan. I don't know why, like, they have to have rhyming names. I don't know. Anyways, Dan and Stan were like, can we come hang out with you guys? We're bored. And we were like, you know what, whatever. The more the merrier. At this point, it was in Cincinnati, where I'm from. Like, a lot of people weren't, like, scared of quarantine. And it's almost like, if you're not high risk and you don't, like, care in a way to get it, and you're, like, not being around too many people, you can hang out. I don't know. That's a whole different controversy. Basically, we ended up hanging out, whatever. We were drinking wine. We were painting. It was a lot of fun. I had met Stan before, but I had never met Dan before. And yeah, so basically we were all hanging out, having a lot of fun, and then Stan was going over to this, he's bisexual, he was going over to this like guy's house that he wanted to hang out with. We like all made our way home. I Ubered home, whatever, and Dan was like, I don't know where to go. I'm home from college, like, don't have a place to stay, but I don't want to stay with Stan while he's doing things with his guy. And I was like, okay, that's understandable, blah blah blah. And he was like, can I please like come over for a couple hours? And at this point it was like 1 to 2 a.m. Like, I don't really like, I can't say that, but I don't usually start a hangout that late. You know what I mean? Cause that's just like, they say nothing good happens after 2 a.m. I would probably agree with that, but we love self-sabotage over here, you know? So me being the people pleaser I am, or was, I guess, I was like, yeah, whatever. I literally straight up texted, I might regret this, but I guess you can come over. He comes over. One thing leads to another. We're hanging out. We're having a good time. We kiss a little bit. Whatever. He goes home, or his friend gets done hanging out. He crashes at his friend's house. That's that. Didn't really think anything of it. A kiss. It's like, I'm 23 years old. A kiss is like a lot, but it's not like this crazy thing that happened. You know what I mean? Like a little, I don't know. Unless it's like a 30-minute makeout sesh, I feel like, and like there's like a connection you have, I'm not gonna be like, oh my God, I hooked up with someone and it's like just a kiss. Like, I would barely even consider that. But that's besides the point. I was so, like, I feel like disassociated during this whole time frame that, like, I don't even 100%. I just looked at the clock at 5:55, and that's why I got these tattoos. And 5:55 is my angel number, and I'm about to cry because, like, if you don't know about, like, if you're into spirituality and stuff, 5:55 means there's transformation coming in your life, positive transformation. So the number means a lot to me. Anyways, Besides the point. Oh God, this video is gonna be a trip to edit. Blah, blah, blah. My friend that we were, whose house we were at, needed help moving out. So she asked all of her guy friends. Finn and Dan ended up coming. I didn't know they would be there, but I ended up going. She's like, hey, I'll give you guys like a bottle of wine each if you will help us move out. Over here, I'm like telling the story. I'm like, am I an alcoholic? But obviously being bored during the pandemic and not having a day off work in like years, I was like, yeah. I was like, yeah, why not? Love being a people pleaser. I'm a yes girl. I say yes to a lot of things. Not something I'm proud of, especially at this point in my life. But yeah, so basically we do that. This guy will like not leave me alone, but it's like in a cute way, definitely like a cute manipulative way. It's like there was a lot of red flags, but I was so after my long-term relationship, not looking for anything serious that would hold me back moving to LA eventually, like following my dreams when it comes to YouTube and such. But I'm also such a like day-to-day person and not a big picture person, where if the immediate gratification was there, I wasn't like connecting it to the big picture, and which is definitely one of my main flaws, I would say. So, you know, as I'm saying yes to all these things, it's like, you want to have a little get together at your house after we move Kendall in? Sure. We all hang out. I'm just gonna fast forward because everything's mushy in between, but basically me and Dan end up hanging out all day every day, but not in like a way like let's hang out. It was like he just like stayed over one night, probably like 2 weeks after we met for the first time. He like stayed over and then he just never left, like literally never left. This man, I want to say like not to talk shit, but if he ever watches this video, like, I mean, I don't care at this point. But this man did not have a car or a debit card. He barely had an ID. He had like a picture of an ID. He lived in Kentucky, which is like, it was like 30 minutes away from me. And well, he stayed the night and then he was like, hey, can you drive me up to my place real quick? I'm gonna shower. You know, my mom will give me money or something. We can get food and then I'll grab some clothes and come back. This guy, basically, that happens for like 2 or 3 days in a row. Obviously, I'm just like going with the flow every single day because I have nothing better to do. I'm getting $700 a week on unemployment for doing absolutely nothing. So I literally was like, what do I have to lose? So I would drive him up, he would get that stuff. We were basically there just to like fill the void of whatever the heck was going on in this world. I was finding anything that would make me smile for 5 minutes, which is like so sad to even like talk about now or think about, but that's totally where my mind was. And yeah, so I basically was with this guy. We ended up kind of forming our own little friend group, whatever. We were with this friend group. They were like, we're only gonna hang out with each other during this whole beginning of quarantine, whatever, until they figure out what the heck is going on with this virus, right? Which is obviously very hard, but like you can't switch around friend groups like that because it's a freaking pandemic. Like it just makes everything like way more confusing. Basically, we end up hanging out every day. He basically stayed over for like 2 months in a row, and it came to the point where like his family was going on family vacations. They wanted me to come. It was like almost, it was only 2 months, but it felt like it could have been a whole year with how much intimate time we spent together, because there was nothing else to do, like at all. We would just go grocery shopping, cook, go to the gym when it was open, all this stuff. It was like, I don't even know if we had a connection at all, but we both just like were there for each other. We just filled that void for each other. Obviously I was happy. I mean, I feel like every honeymoon stage in a relationship is just like, oh my gosh, someone of a different background than me likes me for me, blah, 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 blah. But it's not, when it's in the honeymoon stage, it's not really liking you for you, because the first 2 or 3 months into a relationship, you're ultimately, most people are putting on a mask because they want the other person to like them if they're a little attracted to them. Like that's just how it is, subconsciously or not. It's not like I'm over here like, oh my gosh, like putting on a mask for this guy. I'm like, no. Also, I'm sorry if the lighting's all weird. It just got super dark outside. So I go on his family vacations. I absolutely love his family. Even though I was getting $700 a week, his family was still like supporting me and all the gas that I was paying for him. And then like, you know, an oil change, and like just his family really, really brought me in as one of their own. And I will always appreciate that. His family is what ultimately made it really hard for me to get out of this situation, because I loved them so much. They really, really helped me out when I was in need. And not saying that my family didn't help me out. Oh my gosh, my family did so much as well. I love my family to death. If you guys are watching this, I couldn't ask for a better support system. And I'm so, so thankful and blessed in this lifetime. But yeah, it came to the point where this man would come over, and I was so generous in a sense where he would want something like drugs, and I would be like, you know, I got it for you. Like, I'm getting all this money. I have nothing to do with it rather than pay bills. I don't have like that many bills to pay. And I'm like, you know, I know you don't have that much money. Your family helps me out with food and stuff. Like, okay, I'll help you out with this kind of stuff. And one thing led to another, and drugs are crazy, you guys. It came to the point where we would have like little get-togethers with our friend group, and they would do these things and stay up all night. I'm not gonna lie, I'd participate here and there. I'm not happy about that. I'm not proud to say that. But to a point, I would go to bed and he would be like, oh, I'm just gonna stay up. And I'd be like, okay. Come to find out, my debit card would be missing. And so I would ask where it is. He'd be like, oh, I held on to it. Oh, don't really know how that happened, but things get blurry when you're drinking, whatever. Okay. I go to look for my car in the morning. I'm like, I did not park it here, I know for a fact. He's like, oh, I borrowed it when you were sleeping. I'm like, oh, that's weird. But I was so just like not in reality that like I didn't think it was that weird. You know what I mean? Just so, I guess to put in better words, I was brainwashed. And this man was very manipulative, very narcissistic, and he was young. I forgot to mention he is the youngest person I've ever dated. I've always dated older than me. This guy is 21 and I'm 23, and I think that 21 to 23, even though it's only a 2-year gap, I think they are very, very formative years. He's someone from a very wealthy family. I'm someone who's from the working class family who's always had to work for everything they've had, and that's just the difference between our backgrounds. So in his mind, it's like, oh, money goes, money comes. In my mind, it's like money goes, but you have to work for it to come. Eventually, this man started slowly but surely inching in his insecurities, things that would make him insecure, like me having guy friends, me having any friends at all. You know, it's the cycle, it's almost a cycle of abuse where they get in your feels. You're like, oh my gosh, your wife material, blah blah blah. And they slowly start detaching you from all your closest friends, and then they start throwing out things that aren't good qualities about you. They start tearing you down slowly but surely. I'm so blessed to have only had, for the most part, healthy relationships where I did not partake in this, but I was in such a weird time in my life where I was graduated without a full-time job. Not only that, but I was on unemployment, literally not knowing any like which way my life was going, kind of just very, very lost. And this guy had these plans. He played basketball. He was like, I'm going to Italy overseas for this many $100 a year. He is the first guy that I've ever been with who like wanted a future with me from the get, which is what I was missing from my last relationships. The past three relationships I was in were over a year and a half, but right at that year and a half, 2-year mark, I'm like, what are we doing if we don't want to have a future together? And that's kind of why those relationships kind of skewed out, or whatever you want to call it. Phased out. This guy, you know, told me everything I wanted to hear. He's like, you can do your YouTube videos for free, live in Italy while I get a car and a house and all this stuff, and play basketball. And I'm like, wow, yeah, this sounds great. He's like, I'm gonna be making $400,000. I can support you while you get yourself back on your feet. And I was like, yeah, what's not to love about this? This sounds great. This would be a great life story. Let's do it. I'm such a hopeless romantic. I'm like, is this the fairy tale I've been waiting for? You know what I mean? And at first he really, really treated me like that. But like I said, he slowly started to manipulate me into thinking that my worth was, basically I wasn't worth anything unless it had to do with him. Like my worth was being with him. You know what I mean? It's literally, what do they call it? It's called Stockholm Syndrome. I was definitely a victim of Stockholm Syndrome, where it was like he was almost taking control of me and making me somehow love it. I've always had a motherly nature about me. I feel like I was also destined on this earth to be a mother one day. And in a way, I was mothering him. He just really was younger and needed that guidance. And I would drive him to and from his basketball practices. Like, I literally, like, would send him money for lunch. Like, I was his mother in a way, which is super weird if you talk, like, talking about it out loud with someone I was dating. But it didn't feel weird in the moment because I was so blind. Like, love is just so blinding. But it's funny because I wouldn't even say it like this. None of this was love. It just felt like love. It felt like love because I was needed, but I was needed to fulfill his ego, but he was not needed to fulfill mine. And love isn't real unless it's a two-way street. And I thought so lowly of myself in that time that I thought that that's what I deserved. And not one of you guys deserves that. It might feel like love because you don't want them to get back with their ex, or you don't want them calling you names. It's like almost when someone calls you so many terrible things, it makes you feel like when they call you, give you a compliment, it means double that. But that is just not the case at all, you guys. It's not the case at all. I've gone through three relationships, and all three of those relationships, very long term, no one ever raised their voice at me. No one ever called me names. And why would I start now as a 23-year-old woman with a good head on my shoulders? Why would I start now? You know, sometimes the world doesn't have answers for us, and this is something I'm still asking myself every day. I lost myself. I have no idea who she is, who that girl is. I literally could not tell you. She was just living day to day and hoping for the best. I always thought that one of my best traits was optimism, but it's not a good trait always. You can't, ugh. God, I'm a mess. You can't be optimistic about things that aren't made for you and aren't good for you. And if you're not happy for even 1 second, that is the spirits, the universe, the world telling you that that is not for you. So let's get to the abuse, I guess. That sounded so bad. So I guess I'm just giving you a bunch of blah, 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 whatever. I guess we can get down to the thick of it. The first time he put his hands on me, a lot of it was a lot of manipulation and hurt. Hurtful words, hurtful actions. There was some cheating involved from the other party. There was some, you know, almost cheating involved, all that stuff. Just stuff that hurts so deeply that no one should ever have to go through. And not only that, is that no one should ignore as red flags, because I totally saw that and was like, you know what, we're just having fun. I don't know where my mindset was. I obviously didn't respect myself to in that point in my life to know that that wasn't what meant for me. And let me just tell you, everyone has times in their life like that. I don't like to regret anything in life, but I guess I regret the person I was right there. God, ooh, that's hard to say. It's really hard to admit. But if it never happened, I wouldn't be able to help one of you guys through with it. And if I didn't have this platform, who knows? Thank God for you guys. Thank every single one of you guys for being here. Seriously, I just got chills. I'm holding back so many tears. You have no idea. Anyways, I guess we'll get to the bad stuff that I keep like walking around. Here comes August. Yes, this past couple Augusts ago. I'm going to bring up my camera roll. At this point, there was a lot of fighting. Just fighting that made no sense. It's almost like if I was happy smiling in a group of people or across the room and he saw me smiling, he would literally text me and be like, "F you." Because I was not allowed to be happy if it wasn't like with him or around him. And even if I was, he would be like, there's something suspicious about it. And this is totally all projecting because he was in an abusive relationship with his ex-girlfriend, and they're both basketball players where she was equally as built as him and she had really bad issues with that growing up. So it was like acceptable for them. So I understand in a way, like it's a cycle of abuse. Like it just is most of the time. So, you know, he would have random rages and I would be the thick of it and I would, you know, cry for days. I would feel like a piece of shit. So it was almost to the point where like I felt responsible for him keeping a smile on his face, and I would have this weight on me every day. I'd be like, please, please don't flip the switch. Like it would just be a quick switch that he would flip, and my happiness at that point was him being happy. That's it. When he was happy, I was on top of the world. It felt like a drug. When he wasn't happy, it felt like I was getting carried into the depths of hell. Literally, looking back, it feels like I was an angel and he was a devil, and we were just trying to help pull each other to the other side, and it just wouldn't. We're both like being so stubborn about it, but I guess the weakest link falls through. Oh, that's so sad. It's so sad. Whew. Thank you, YouTube, for being my therapy today. Anyways, so one day I was just chilling at home. I was having a really big self-care day. One of my favorite things to do, if you follow me on Instagram, you know, I take baths like 3 times a week. I mostly post about them. Just, I love me a good bath, you know what I mean? So I was taking bath, I was reading my book, I was watching my series at the time, and I was just so content in my robe, in bed, about to fall asleep. It's like 1 a.m. at this point. And everything in Cincinnati, in Ohio, was shut down. But bars in Kentucky were open. It's this weird like thing during the pandemic where like Ohio and Kentucky are like 100% opposite. So if people like want to go out in Ohio, or if they did want to go out in Ohio, they would just go across the river, which is literally 10 minutes away, and just go out in Kentucky. Like, you can Uber there for the same price as Ubering somewhere in Cincinnati. It's crazy. But he did live in Kentucky, so he was home for the night, hanging out with his brothers and his brother's friends and such. And he was like texting me being like a psycho, and I'm like, you know what, you're drunk, it makes sense. You're drunk, just have a good time, like, just Uber home, like, whatever. I know your parents' credit card's on your Uber, like, you'll be fine. He's like, Sarah, like, making no sense. He's like, Sarah, I need you to pick me up right now. The cops are about to come, like, they're on their way. All my family and friends left me here, blah, blah, blah. There's no one here. Kept calling me and, like, would not stop. I could not even send a text back without, but every time I answered the phone, it would just be screaming and like gibberish that I like literally could not understand at all. And I would just sit there, like my heart would race, be like, calm down, and like, please calm down, you are acting a lunatic. I'll text your mom, like, we'll find you a ride home, like, don't worry about it. He's like, no, bitch, like, don't text my mom, don't do all this, whatever, like, come get me, please come get me, blah blah blah. And like, you know how when you have a gut feeling? Yeah, never, don't ever ignore your gut feeling, you guys. Don't ever ignore your gut feeling. I had a gut feeling that it was maybe not a good idea to do that. But I was also over here like, I guess this is my boyfriend. He's literally begging for me to come pick him up. I guess in my mind I was like treating him like he is my child, and I was like, I don't want him to go to jail. So my dumbass makes the terrible decision to drive up to the bar and pick him up. And as soon as I pull into the bar, his brother and all of his friends were next to my car getting in. They were like, oh, hey, Sarah, what are you doing here? And then out of nowhere, out of the bushes, comes Dan flying, literally flying with so much rage on his face. No cops to be seen, by the way. Starts going at it at my car window, like as hard as can be. And I am broke. I can't afford a new car window. At that point, I'm like, you cannot break my car window right now. Like, you can't. And he was literally full force, like I thought it was about to crack. So I crack it a little and I'm like, will you like relax? Number one, you told me that your family left. They're standing right here laughing their asses off. What is going on with you? No words, no, just gibberish. So I was like, I'm scared of you right now. I'm very, very deeply scared of you right now. If you get in my car, can you sit in the back seat? Obviously, like, that was like, what the fuck to him? Like, couldn't comprehend that. And so I went to unlock the car. Now, obviously, as soon as I unlocked the car, dumb decision, he opens the front door immediately, gets in the car, and for the first time in my life, trigger warning, I was used as a punching bag. My head, I'll just show you. I got beat the fuck up. And I grew up with two brothers and a dad. And a mom, I've never, ever had anyone lay their hands on me. Almost to the point where I was ignorant that it would ever be able to happen. And I didn't know what to do. My ears were ringing. I couldn't hear anything. I was in the middle of the parking lot. In the middle of the street. I wasn't even parked yet. I got a black eye. Behind my ear, I had a concussion. I don't know if you can see that. It was the craziest thing I've ever been through. And I'm looking at these pictures, it almost still doesn't feel like it was me. Oh my gosh, look how swollen my face was. Like, this feels like I'm looking at someone else. Yeah, so that happened. And it got worse. I'm not gonna go into crazy, crazy detail. He wouldn't leave my car, so luckily the bar he was at was right down the street from his house, so I said, I'm just gonna take you home. I went to take him home, and he was psychotic. I would say it was a psychotic breakdown. It didn't stop, obviously. I did make him go in the back seat to take him home, but no, I didn't. Wait, I tried to. I just, like, got myself together for a second, but basically I've been talking for a long time, so I'm gonna kind of speed it up a little bit. But he wouldn't accept that I was driving him home and that I wasn't driving him to my apartment that he basically lived at. He was like, I need my clothes, like I need my clothes fast. Like, I guess with his ex, he has some trauma that like he never got any of his clothes back. I don't know, but obviously some unresolved things going on in his brain. And I was like, I'm sorry, I am not gonna steal your clothes. I just don't feel comfortable being around you tonight or right now at all. And I was like, you need help. I need help at this point. Like, the cops should come. So I went to drive him home and he like tried to take my wheel and like steer it off the road. And it was very, very scary stuff. And it came to the point where I got that all on film so that if I did pass away, that like someone would know what happened. And which is like the scariest thing ever when you are literally so low. Like, I felt like it was like out of a movie scene. Like, I was so low that I put my camera, my phone, and this is something that you guys should all do if you're ever in the situation, which I hope, I pray to God that no one, not one of you guys gets in the situation. But if you are ever in a situation like this where you are seriously scared for your life, get your phone and put it on record on a video, whether you can see yourself or not, put it on the side of your seat and have that footage. Like, you have no idea how much that helped me and that how glad I am that I had that mental stability to think that far. So I went to his mom and dad lived in separate neighborhoods, like right next to each other. So I went to his mom's house to drop him off, and basically he wouldn't let me leave the car. So I left the car and I ran to the front door and banged on it as hard as I could. I tried to, but he like ran after me and like tackled me to the ground and started just, you know, pulling me from my hair. Just like the most crazy things. And the fact that I'm like saying this with a straight face like probably looks so psycho to you guys, but it's so like I said, it's far removed from my memory, because that's how I deal with things. It's like so far removed from my memory that like I feel like I'm telling a story about like someone that was actually in a movie or something. But anyways, luckily, thank God, a neighbor heard or saw or whatever me screaming help and called the cop. Thank you to whoever neighbor that was. If this neighbor knew how important that was, I owe them my life. Like, I don't know if I would be alive today, but I guess he got a call about domestic violence and I went to leave the neighborhood and he wouldn't let me leave, and he found my phone and he threw it into the woods. His brother came and found out what was happening, just drove back or by us, like leaving the bar himself, and tried to talk some sense into him, and there was no sense happening. The cops end up coming, and of course, at the same time as his dad pulls up, and his dad is the one who has helped me financially so much. Dan was in the back of my car at this point, and Dan's dad was standing out next to the cop, basically waiting for me to say something, and that is when I lied to a cop. I legitimately felt like I had no other choice. I had blood coming from my eye, my lips, my ear. There was blood coming out of my ear. And this cop looked me in the eye and said, did this guy lay his hands on you? And I had all these people staring at me. And I said, no. I was so low that I didn't have the strength to say yes. And I didn't have the will to ruin someone's life, even though they like basically ruined mine. I've always said I never want to stoop below where someone wants me to go, but I definitely should have in that moment. Definitely should have. So after that happened, the cops couldn't do anything, because even though in my eyes he knew that it had happened, I didn't admit it. So essentially, he left. He asked if I'd prefer Dan to go with his dad home, and I said yes. Dan would not let that happen. I said, we're going straight to your dad's house, and that's it. We got in the car, and he still tried to go on the highway to my house. We got to his house. I brought him inside. I said, yeah, this is it. And it wasn't it. His dad wouldn't let me leave. He said, it's too late to leave. I think his dad was scared that the cop was gonna stick around in case my car left and ask me what really happened. I had to sleep in a different room and hear all the terrible things he was saying about me to everyone. His dad almost liked me more than he liked him at that point. He was telling his dad how terrible of a human I was, even though all I was doing is picking him up from the bar that he was begging me to pick him up from to drive him home. I'm still just confused what I did to deserve it. Still healing, obviously. And the worst part is that that's not the last time it happened. I was strong enough to walk away for 2 to 3 weeks, but I was still so brainwashed. And I was in this mindset that it was just a psychotic episode. It was a one-time thing. His mom and dad reassured me, this has never happened. This will never happen. This is so out of character for him. This is like, they were just shocked. I was shocked. The worst part is he barely apologized. He didn't realize that he did something wrong. He was more worried about making sure I had enough makeup on my face when I was going in public than making sure that I was healing correctly. You can't tell, this is all very fresh for me, so that's why I've tried to film this video week in with week out, and it hasn't gone anywhere because it's hard to talk about. I'm gonna finish this video, but like I said, this video is already super, super long, and that's not the end of it. So I think I'm gonna break this up into two parts so you're not watching an hour and a half of a video, and I hope that this was interesting to you. I know it didn't help you so far because you don't know how I got out of the situation, but it does get better. I did get out, and I'm doing much, much better now. But if you want to see part two, the second part of how I absolutely ended it for good, how I didn't let him kind of squirm his way back into my life again, comment down below. I'm going to film it after this anyways, but if you want to see it, it will be the next video I have on my channel. So subscribe if you're not subscribed already. And in the next video, I'll be talking about the scar. I got this scar from him, and I will look at it in the mirror every day and remind myself what I've been through and how I've come back stronger and how I will never stoop that low ever again. So basically part two ends up with me ending up in the hospital, very traumatic. I know you guys probably don't want to hear about part two, but part two is going to be the more inspirational part where I explain more how hard it was to get out of it, but how worth it was. So like I said, please give this video a like or comment down below if you want to see that. I'll be uploading it probably like immediately after this video, but we shall see what you guys respond to this video first. I love you guys with my whole heart. Thank you guys so much for listening. I would love for you guys to tell your stories if you're comfortable in the comment section down below, or DM me on Twitter, DM me on Instagram, just tweet me if you want to talk about anything. I love you guys so much. I'll talk to you guys in part two. Bye. Hey.